Let's see what the stew has for us today.
Welcome to the Gnomecast, Gnome Stew's tabletop gaming advice podcast. Here we talk with the other gnomes about gaming things to avoid becoming part of the stew, so I guess we'd better be good. This episode is brought to you by our awesome Patreon backers like the Gatorful Eric Bontz, the Egalitarian Eric Heimel, and the Fantastical Fabrice Boulakia. Today we have myself along with Tomas, and we are going to do away with our opening Get to Know a Gnome question, because this episode is all about getting to know Tomas, our newest gnome. Now, Tomas,
yep.
You are our first gnome not from North America. Can you tell us about where you're from?
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Tomas, you just said. I am from Argentina. It's a country, if you live in the US, I'm from the other part of the world, the southern part from America. Not America, the US, but the whole continent of America. And my country, Argentina, is a pretty wide territory that is pretty well known for its landscapes and territory. At some time in the past, we used to be the world's barn because we exported the vegetables, the fruits, the meat, everything came from here, but that stopped after a while. The country is also known for the Iguazu Waterfalls, that is one of the, or was, I can't recall, one of the seven wonders of the world. Also, we are also known for some very great food in here that we say it's from us, but the countries around us, like Uruguay, Paraguay, Chile, say it's from their territory. We aren't sure, so I'm going to eat some dulce de leche, asado, that is some kind of meat that is amazing and you have to try out. We also are great at doing ice cream, it's amazing.
Yeah, Argentina's big. It's not a small country.
Yeah, it's not as big as the US, but it's still pretty big. Isn't doing so well economically speaking, but apart from that, it's a really nice country to come and see.
Now, the native language in Argentina is Spanish?
It's Spanish. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, because I always get a little confused because I know Brazil does Portuguese.
Yeah.
But most everyone else does Spanish. And I'm like, I don't want to get confused there.
No, you know, yeah. From Latin America, you have Brazil that speaks Portuguese, and the Guyana, the French Guyana, I don't know if you say it differently, is from France, but all the rest from South America and Central America speaks Spanish.
Now, why don't you tell us what your gamer origin story is? How did you start playing role-playing games?
Well, I've got to thank my cousins for that, because they were the ones who introduced me to computer games. Everything went up from there. I started with computer games. Then my parents bought me the NES, or as we call it here, the family console. Then that was when I was still a child. And I started with RPGs much later, I think when I was 21 years old, because it was on January 2017 that I started playing regularly RPGs. But how I was introduced was by a friend of mine that came and went to GM some D&D, and the game didn't last long because he had some expectations about the game that he didn't get to meet, and to be honest, he didn't DM that well. But
I mean, everyone has to start somewhere.
Yeah, and that's why 1 year later, after Stranger Things came out, a friend of mine came to me and said that he was looking at D&D and was thinking of maybe starting a game, but we need a DM, and who could be that DM? And well, that was like he was trying to tell me to DM the game for them. And so I jumped on the wagon and I started doing it.
That's kind of funny that your, you know, final push into D&D was Stranger Things, where I'm looking at Stranger Things because I was a kid in the 80s, so I actually remember sitting in people's basements playing D&D, like the kids in the show.
I'm a kid from the 90s because I was born in 1995. So I didn't get to see all the 80s stuff, but it was really Stranger Things that really introduced me to D&D, I think. Mm-hmm. So as far as I know, it is for a lot of other people. So
that's awesome.
Yeah, it's great to have more people on D&D wagon.
Did you have much trouble like making that transition to running games without having a whole lot of experience playing them?
It's weird because my first game I sucked at it. I did terrible. But my friends liked it nonetheless, and I liked it as well. So we kept trying, and after doing terrible mistakes in the game, like having the warlock play all three subclasses at the time on one same character and doing a ton of damage. The language difference also was something to meddle with because we didn't have the rules in Spanish. We had mm-hmm. to translate them.
Yeah, before we recorded, you mentioned that like a lot of gaming happens kind of with this weird mixture of English and Spanish.
Yeah,
in Argentina,
we call it Spanglish for that very reason, because we do have terms for like grapple in Spanish, like agarrar, but we nonetheless use the English terms because it's much easier to use them and mm-hmm. use the rules to search them. There are also character sheets in Spanish and other options, but we just got used to playing in English, so we do it that way.
Now, do most of your players have at least some English?
Yes. I am the one that has the better level of English, but nonetheless, they all speak very fluently, even though we don't need to because we play in Spanish. We just use the English terms for the different abilities and conditions, maybe.
That would be funny. I'd probably be sitting there like, oh, I got that word. I know that one.
Yeah, it's pretty much that.
So, you know, you've mentioned D&D. What style of game do you like to play?
Well, as far as styles of play, I just became an engineer, so I wouldn't say I'm very good with numbers, but I'm used to using numbers in my life and being very structured. And my friends are as well, so we do play a very crunchy style of game. Rules heavy, mm-hmm. so we like great scenes of combat. We have done some kind of war-like games in D&D, even though the game isn't ready and designed to do that. We had some crazy combats with orcs that were from the army from Asmodeus and things like that going on.
So, like actual big battles instead of just little team combats against a
single
monster.
That's how it started, but as time went on, I started discovering more RPGs, and as I did that, I started to understand that I actually preferred rules-light games,
mm-hmm.
but my friends still prefer crunchy games, so we still play D&D as we used to play, and sometime I'll get them to play for a while some other game. Someday.
Have you started trying to like slip in some of the rules light style or philosophy into your game and like just have them not notice?
Well, I did because as I started writing for Tribality, I started to try out some different games, and to do that, I needed to play the game.
Mm-hmm.
I have to thank my players for at least trying those games out with me to make a review or some comparison with other games. And as we did that, we managed to understand that there were many rules to steal from other games and import into D&D,
mm-hmm.
like the clock system from Blades in the Dark. I haven't played that game yet, but I'm looking forward to do that and steal that mechanic because it sounds amazing.
Yeah. I'm a big fan of the way like the gumshoe system hands out clues and mysteries. You know, that one's just like that just goes into all the games I run now.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter the system, it's like this is how we're gonna handle clues from here on out.
Well, I got to play Waterdeep Dragon Heist, the adventure, and I did it in a very detective-like and mystery kind of way. So I used a lot of Gamshu and also used the Alexandrian remits to pick some sort of new stuff to add into the game. If you are playing Waterdeep Dragon Heist, take a look at that because it's amazing.
Yeah, I actually ran Dragon Heist for my crew, and you know, it's a good adventure, but there's still some parts in there where I'm like, have you actually, like, did the writers ever actually play with real players? Because there's some sections that are just don't play well as written, so you have to kind of adapt some of it, especially depending upon how your group interacts with things.
Yeah, there's a lot to adapt from that book. So I was reading it. I started reading one of the chapters with one of the villains, like Manshun, and then I read Charlatzel and Sanatar, and I wanted to have them all in my game. And the Castle Hunters. So I did just that. I ported them all into my game, and the adventure just went from one side to the other. It had fireballs going through. Manshun killed one of the characters at one point, so they seeked revenge and ended up killing him with the black staff. So yeah, I'm not spoiling anything, by the way, because this was all made up by me.
Just for our audience's sake, what the adventure presents is, like, it presents you with four different ultimate bad guys, and it's very easy to just introduce all four of them or their factions into the game anyway. My players actually met Jarlaxle, even though he wasn't the ultimate bad guy, but half of my players were convinced he was the bad guy.
Oh, I loved playing Jarlaxle. I picked some sort of French accent for him that I loved making, and my players loved it as well. So I had some shenanigans going on with him.
That's awesome. Now, you mentioned that you started writing for Tribality a while ago. What made you start wanting to write about games?
Well, I didn't want to start writing about games. It was just something that I had some free time. I studied English in high school, and I started to lose it as I went. I started going on college and never getting to practice it. So I just thought that I could use this thing I like, D&D, and started writing about it. So I got myself a blog and wrote some stuff and promoted it on Reddit until Sean Ellsworth, the one that is managing Tribality, saw my stuff and just told me to come in and start writing for them. And that's where it all began.
That's awesome. Because like, you've been working on a pretty cool series of articles for us that's kind of a mashup of monsters. Can you tell us? Tell us about the inspiration for that series and kind of where you're going with it.
Well, I think that what started me to write and care about writing monsters was when I first wrote my Demogorgons from Stranger Things. I did a stat block for them for Tribality for Halloween, I think, on 2018, maybe.
We can put a link in the show notes.
Yeah. I wrote some different variations because as the show went on, they did start adding new types of Demogorgons, like the Demodogs and things like that, that are very different from the Demogorgon from D&D, but nonetheless, they have the same name. I just wanted to pick those monsters and make stat blocks for them. I liked it so much that Sean grabbed me and got me hooked on starting writing about Seas of Odari and Under the Seas of Odari monster for them. These two are books that I did for Tribality that you should check out because they are amazing. And I did about half the monsters from those books. Well, Under the Seas of Odari isn't out yet. It just got a successful Kickstarter and it's coming soon.
Very cool. Again, we'll get it in the show notes.
Okay. Well, from up there, I just started writing monthly encounters and different ways to run monsters. And just from that, I started getting hooked on writing how two different monsters could have something in common and why they should be working together or as enemies. That's how the inspiration for this series came out.
Yeah, because you the article that you've I believe there's a second article on this monster combo that will be published soon, probably around the time before this podcast is out. But the one you've published as of our recording is the Fire Giant Lovecraftian Ghasts combo.
Mm-hmm.
What were you going for with that one?
Well, to be honest, and I am going to recommend doing this to a lot of DMs, I just grabbed the monster manual and picked one page. I got the Fire Giant, and I said, I'm going to write about this Fire Giant. I started thinking, well, what other monster can I pick? I grabbed the gold from Call of Cthulhu because I wanted to meet in both games. And even though golds are in D&D, the ones mm-hmm. from Call of Cthulhu are very different from them because they can shamble like kangaroos, and that's terrifying. And that's how the idea came to being. I just mixed up the two of them and started thinking of ways on how the two of them could work together. And that's how the Valkyrie Fire Giant came to be.
That's very cool. What other types of articles can the audience look forward to from you?
I'm looking forward to writing all sorts of different articles. I was thinking about writing articles about game design, maybe, because that's a passion of me.
Mm-hmm.
I have also written for my guest article some rules to apply to D&D that yep. were like a different sort of inventory to use in your game, inspired by the Diablo 2 video game.
Yeah, like a little mini game for how to handle inventory. Mm-hmm,
that has some mixing with Tetris. So if you like that, check that out as well. And well, I'm looking forward to writing some sort of articles like those, maybe more about monsters as well, and as well as how to run monsters and how to create your own ones.
Awesome.
Yep.
Awesome.
More like that.
Is there anything else you wanna share with our audience? Because I think we've covered all of the questions I originally came up with.
Well, if you like all about game designing, preferably level design, because that's the thing that I am more passionate about, you can check out my stuff and go into my Twitter, and I write about all sorts of things, going from Marvel superheroes to nerdy stuff, video games, RPGs. I'm trying to play more RPGs and started a gaming group a while ago to try out more different games to recommend.
Awesome.
So yeah, if you like all those sorts of stuff, come follow me on Twitter and we can chat.
And we'll get him to put more of that stuff in the articles on the Stew too.
So. Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to writing that.
So I think we've covered most of the stuff. So let's get into our outro. This show is funded by the Gnome Stew Patreon. You too can become a Patreon backer by following the Patreon link on the Gnome Stew website to the Gnome Stew Patreon. This ad is brought to you by the Nomadic Author Creator. Need some new gnomes to add fresh new content to the blog? We'll just use our Nomadic Author Creator. Toss in a bunch of gamers and out will pop a fresh, ready-to-write author. Results not guaranteed. If you're enjoying the Gnomecast, you'll probably like many of the other Misdirected Mark shows. Here's one to check out.
Panda's Talking Games. Phil and Senda answer your questions about RPGs from the perspective of one-shots and campaigns, with some panda silliness. If you listen to it, you will love it. Or so the rumors say.
You can find all of us at GnomeStew.com, at GnomeStew on Twitter, and GnomeStew on Facebook. Tomas, where else can we find you on the internet?
Well, you can find me primarily on Twitter at TJimenezRGM. I'm going to spell it out, just in case. TJIMENEZRGM.
We have a very long history with people having to spell out their Twitter handles. Just ask Senda.
Yeah, it's a Spanish name, so I just in case.
And we'll have links in the show notes, too. So
yeah.
You can also find me on Twitter and Instagram as Orikes13, O-R-I-K-E-S-13. Though, as always, Twitter is pretty much dead for me right now, and Instagram is mostly pictures of cats. But there you go. So I'm going to make the call that we avoided the Stew this week because you're new and we still need more articles out of you.
Mm-hmm.
That sound
well,
good to you?
Well, thank you for that. As long as I keep out from the Stew, I'm going to keep writing. So please keep me away from it.
Gnomecast is hosted by Misdirected Mark Productions, the media arm of Encoded Designs.
Now it's recording.